This is Amateur Logic episode 102 for March 15th, 2017. This episode of Amateur Logic was brought to you by MFJ, the world leaders in ham radio accessories at mfjenterprises.com, and by ICOM. Time to put away those winter boots and spring forward with ICOM. Good evening and welcome to another exciting episode of Amateur Logic. I'm George.
I'm Tommy.
I'm Peter.
And I'm Emile.
And as always, it is great to be back.
It is.
It's turned a little cool here in Mississippi tonight. I don't know if it's got down there to you yet, has it, Emile?
Yeah, it's a little bit cooler, around the high 60s over here, if you want to call that cool.
Yeah, well, it is.
It's pretty chilly here. I had to actually wear a jacket. But it's been really nice, apparently. I think probably by next week, I'm going to have to start cutting the grass at home.
Yeah, I probably should have done it this week, but oh well. Peter, how are things in Australia?
Oh, warm. It's actually a relatively warm day, and we've actually had a spell of, I don't know, a month or two of just warm but not extremely hot weather. It's been very, very pleasant here in Melbourne of late.
That's kind of the way it's been here, too. We've had a little more rain than I would like, considering some of the places I have to drive. But other than that, it's been pretty nice.
Yeah, my yards needed it, though.
Yeah, it did.
No twisters down in Mississippi at all?
Not recently.
Not lately. Mm-mm. Let's keep it that way.
Yep. Well, you know, anytime we're doing a show, we've got a chat room going on at the same time. Join them. Over in there right now, there's a good group of folks over in there. AmateurLogic.TV/chat. If you're watching the recording of the show, there probably won't be anybody in the chat room. Or if there is...
Actually, there'll probably be a couple of people in there, but we won't be there.
Yeah.
And, but, there's some that just kind of hang out in there all the time. I think they just leave the computer connected.
Yeah.
But, that usually happens when it's live, so... Watch for the posts, and if you're watching the recorded one, watch the social media outlets for the post and join us when we film live. And a lot of people find it kind of entertaining to see some of the behind-the-scenes stuff.
Yeah, a few people do.
I know a few people. There's one in particular that really enjoys it if something's not going so smooth. So.
Yeah. To tell the truth, I think there's a lot of folks in there that enjoy seeing some of the pains and behind-the-scenes. Stuff that goes on here. You know, we only do Amateur Logic once a month, so it's not like we ever really get practiced up and good at it before we take a break for another month.
Well, we got 2 weeks.
Well,
we do
ham college.
Yeah, but the month thing sounded good.
Well, I thought it was more legit sounding.
Yeah.
Anyway, join them over there in the chat room, and we're in there too. We glance at it as we can throughout the show. See what's happening there. Well, Tommy, what have you been up to?
Well, I kind of took it easy this month. I don't have a segment.
That's true, but we've got a full show nevertheless.
We do have a full show, so it's we've here lately we've been running way over. So
yeah, we have.
I've been playing around with redoing my DV Mega software and doing some few things like that. So hope to have some of that coming up pretty soon. Got a new handy talkie I've been playing with, and I hope to show some of that pretty quick.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah, so got some good stuff coming.
Well, Peter, what have you been up to lately?
Well, I did some repairs on my laptop, and that's my segment for this month. And I actually launched my balloon, and you'll probably see some footage and other bits and pieces from that next month. So, I've been quite busy down here. Unfortunately, my balloon Well, you'll have to wait and find out what happened to that.
Yep, yep. We'll all be waiting, Peter.
Yeah, looking forward to it.
Emile, what about down south there? What's been going on?
Well, down south, and I guess I got to blame it all on you guys. I'm head over heels totally into the Raspberry Pi, and the Bites of Pi saga continues. That's right. Fist pump, it's your fault, and I'm stuck and going to be there for a while.
Yep. Just wait till we get them on the Arduinos.
Don't. Yeah. I still think the Raspberry Pis are the best. Have you ordered one of the new Pis yet? Zero W, I think it's called, with the wires?
No. I did expand my inventory of 3Bs. I got two more of those recently for other projects, but I haven't ordered one of the other ones. But I did get to do a poll on the Facebook forum, and that's one of the things we're going to talk about.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, that'll be fun. Well, I've been more or less doing the same stuff here. I did revisit that 433 megahertz project that we looked at a couple of months ago, where we got, maybe 2 feet distance out of it there. Well.
Did you figure out what was wrong?
Yeah, and I did a little experimenting and a little test and measurement there.
Testing and measuring. That's good stuff.
That is good stuff.
Should be interesting.
Should be. Well, I got some sad news I hate to bring forth tonight, but I don't think it's unexpected news. March 8th, General Wireless Operations Incorporated, doing business as Radio Shack, the neighborhood electronics convenience store, announced the company filed voluntary petitions under Chapter 11 in the U.S. Bankruptcy Court. So, Radio Shack has filed bankruptcy, I guess, again.
Oh, wow.
RadioShack.com stores and dealer locations across the country are still currently open for business and serving customers. The company is closing approximately 200 stores and evaluating options on the remaining 1,300. I don't know which 200 stores. I haven't been able to find a list yet.
Yeah.
The company and its advisors are currently exploring all available strategic alternatives to maximize value for creditors, including the possibility of keeping stores open on an ongoing basis.
I actually didn't realize they had 200 still open. I honestly didn't.
They've got 1,500 open.
Yeah, see, but I had no idea.
I don't think anybody else did either.
Yeah, apparently that might be the problem. Yeah.
Well, sad to see them go that way.
The first time they went, it was sad. The second time, it's like, probably should have just stayed dead the first time.
Yeah. It's kind of we'll have to start a new series, sort of like The Walking Dead.
Yeah.
Some big Radio Shack employees walking around. Because, a lot of people are probably going to lose their jobs. But
that's the worst part about it.
It's been going that way, steadily downhill. You know, I'll go in the local one here occasionally, but it's rare I really find what I need.
Yeah. Have you been in it since they shut down and reopened?
I have. And I noticed on their website, RadioShack.com, this week when they did that, they've announced a bunch of clearance sales on there. They got stuff up to 50% off. And so I went and looked at some of the prices and compared them to what I could buy it the same item for from, say, MCM Electronics. And with the clearance sale, the prices at Radio Shack now are only about twice what they are in other places.
Oh, they really slashed them.
Yeah, slashed them quite a bit. So, you know, that couldn't have been helping them. I mean, you know, when I go in there and I see, a connector for $8 that I could buy somewhere else for $1.50.
Yeah.
You know.
So they still had some of that stuff.
A little bit.
They had the little bins with all the parts and stuff still in there?
Well, some of the spots were empty in them, but, they still had the bins.
Huh, interesting.
It's just, it's not the same store anymore, and we'll just have to see what the next chapter is going to be like there.
Yeah, I think they're going to close the book before it's over.
I think that's probably the way it's headed. Sad. Well, you know, we always talk about our Amateur Logic swag.
Yeah, that we don't have on tonight.
But you're wearing the K9 MIT swag there, aren't
yeah.
you?
Yeah. Sure am.
Yeah. For just, you know, an honor.
Yeah, Chip he's there. In there, too.
Yeah.
This is for you, Chip. The K9 part fell off.
Yeah, it's on the back. Yeah.
I should have wrote one on paper and stuck it on there.
You know,
a sticky note or something.
Yeah, our friend John Baggett, K2BAG, was, I don't know, he is in the chat room. Hi there, John. Well, you know, we had the photo he caught of the AmateurLogic cap at the Atlanta airport last month. Well, apparently he's done some more traveling, and the AmateurLogic swag made it with him.
Awesome.
We've got, here's one right here. This is from the HR store, or HRO. Yeah, in Oakland, California.
Ah, cool.
Yeah,
representing awesome, John.
There. He also, wow, he found a couple of others, Tommy. He went by your place.
Yeah. You guys should come by there and see me later.
Yeah, get a good sandwich.
Yeah, and something to drink.
And some cocktails. And, you know, when you've had enough to eat and you're about drunk, just stagger on down the street, and you can stay at the King George Hotel.
Yeah, there you go.
Nice. Mm-hmm. I think that's out of my price range.
Yeah, I think it's probably out of mine,
too. It's pretty good for business, so I set them up, and then you just get the rest of their money there at the hotel.
Well, we got Winston's bar inside there, so.
Yeah. Guess they wake up thirsty again.
Well, thanks for that, John. We always like to see
John. John represents well.
He does.
He absolutely does.
He really does. And imagine, I'm sure he was as dumbfounded as we were when he found your sandwich joint in my hotel.
Yeah. I didn't know anybody knew where that place was.
I didn't either. But not to be outdone, there's been some more swag on the move. And that's, Ralph Mills has been out there.
Oh,
and he said the AmateurLogic hat can be seen in less wanky places than those visited by John Baggett. Here is atop a knee-deep snow on our barn roof in Maine. Ralph.
You know, you got to have some long legs for that roof to be at your knees.
You do, and that's a pretty tall shovel, too. <You know?
laughs> Looks like the AmateurLogic TV Frosty didn't make it.
It didn't.
Wow, I couldn't imagine that much snow, man.
And then, not to be outdone, Mike, VE3, MIC, came back and said, right back at you, Ralph.
Oh, it's a competition. Who's going to be next?
It's a good question, but boy, that hat has really made the rounds, hasn't it?
It has. You know, that's one of the things of our own swag I don't even own. Not much of a hat wearer, I may have to get one. I travel a good bit. I may have to do some of my own swag pictures.
You do. You need to be swagging it up, man.
Yeah, I'll be going to Utah, Arizona soon, South Texas, and then the usual Dallas, so. I'm going to have to see about taking the cap and get some pictures myself.
Yep, that would be good. Well, one other thing I need to mention here. You know, we had that tool circular last month that we were looking at.
Yeah, those were cool.
The Hazard Fraught tools.
Mm-hmm.
And there was one item in there we just really didn't know what it was.
Mm-hmm.
Did I mention this to you already?
No.
I haven't, okay.
I mean, I remember from last month.
Okay. But. Well, you know, we had the 6-inch well gutting knife there. And if you needed to gut a 6-inch well, I think that's exactly what you'd need to use.
It looks like that would be right on target.
And also a left-handed mohel knife. Well, I wasn't pronouncing that correctly. Yeah, and you see there's a picture of a whale on the handle of the whale gutting knife.
Uh-huh.
And I couldn't identify that fish on the other knife. That, by the way, that's pronounced mole.
A mole? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So is that a mole?
It's also ideal for most walrus brisket.
Walrus brisket. I hadn't had any of that.
No, it's not what we thought at all. Turns out that a mole is a Jewish guy that is practiced in the art of circumcision.
Oh.
So.
Definitely hazard fraught.
Yes.
So I can't remember, because I lost the email or the message who told me about that. I think Russell is the one who brought that to attention. But
yeah, we were way off on that.
At least we cleared it up. He said the reason it was so cheap is because there's probably not a lot of left-handed moles.
You know? Okay.
So there you go. Well, Tommy, why don't you bail us out on that one?
Yeah, I'm not sure I can. I do have an email. This is from Andrew, KM6IEO. He says, "Hi, Tommy, I received my call sign today, KM6IEO. I'm going to think of a vanity one. Anyhow, my question is, what would you recommend for my first ham radio rig? There's so much stuff to learn that's not covered in the exam book. I have about $400 to start with, and I'll be using it as a base rig, more than likely a mobile radio in a base format," which a lot of us do that. They seem cheaper. I have looked at Kenwood, Icom, Alinco, etc. They all have good radios in my price point. Should I get a single band or a dual band? I found a local club to join. Their next meeting isn't until the end of the month. Can you help with suggestions? And I would say that if you can afford it, we actually talked about this not too long ago, I think, on Ham College.
Mm-hmm.
But if you can afford it, I say get the dual band. You're basically getting twice the radio.
Yeah.
And wouldn't you agree?
Yeah, I mean,
it just depends
on
your
price
point.
That's what everybody told me when I bought my first VHF-only radio.
Yeah. Well, I bought my first one was, my first mobile was a 2-meter only, and then I kind of regretted it. So yeah. I would say if you can afford it, to go ahead and get that. But you're also going to need a power supply and an antenna. So I'm assuming maybe you have another budget for that. But yeah, all of those brands that you mentioned are good radios. I would personally probably steer away from some of the Chinese ones, because you kind of get what you pay for, I think. But, you know, you'll have to weigh that out. And obviously we kind of lean towards some of the Icom ones here. But all of those are great radios. I don't think you'll go wrong with any of them.
Yeah.
So.
Well, Emile, you've got you got something cheap for us tonight. You want to set it up?
Sure. So my Bites of Pie episodes continue since I am head over heels into those pies, and I've decided to make me a little 2-meter or VHF or UHF beacon project with some a little bit different than the norm as far as keying goes. So check it out.
Hello, George, Peter, and Tommy. Today I decided to put together a beacon, a VHF, or not-so-common VHF or UHF, depending on the rig, beacon with using the Raspberry Pi and a radio and some software that I wrote to make it all work and to make it comply to the keep it simple stupid or KISS rule. Here you can see the beacon. It's a multi-mode beacon using multiple modes at CW and BPSK 63 that I used FL Digi to record, and that's being decoded successfully through the Ham Radio Deluxe running on this computer, and it is controlled via a simple bash script that I ran or wrote specifically for this. Now, what kind of separates this one from others is the keying is all happening via the audio output jacks of the Pi going straight into the microphone jacks of the rig. You can see it's transmitting there.
Running on a Raspberry Pi.
And that's the
Beofang.
That is the audio version, or recorded audio. And there's also the multi-mode digital, and they alternate between those two. I'll show you that in a minute. So the keep it simple, stupid principle behind this is the fact that what I really did here is used audio files, two different audio files, one multi-mode digital modes and the other one a voice recording of me speaking the beacon. That's running here in a terminal or shell. It was written in Bash as a script on the Raspberry Pi. Very simple loop, basically an infinite loop alternating between those two files that's stored on the Pi. What I used to actually create those is FL Digi, because I took the output from FL Digi's digital modes, multiple digital modes, and recorded them to these OGG or OGG audio files, and then made that alternate. And the Pi is simply putting out audio out to the rig here. Now I did happen to also hop over to Dave's Hobby Shop in Arkansas and pick up a set of these adapters so that I can hook it up to my outside antennas, which I'll do. There's kind of what I use this for is whether or not, you know, people around me will know that I'm in the shack when this beacon is working, and of course if there's any propagation ducting or other atmospheric events, you'd be surprised at how far you can hear these things out. So anyway, that's the cheap old man, not so common Raspberry Pi beacon project there. Another cool aspect of the Raspberry Pi, of course, is the networking abilities, and it's running on a local network I have here in the shack through the remote connectivity, which is the VNC program, which is a little bit more secure version included with the Pi. I like what they're doing there. So good stuff for remoting and controlling this as needed, depending on the situation. Sometimes you might have to shut down the beacon, and it's one of the other things I wanted to mention. The beacon itself is running within a certain range in the VHF 2-meter band that is allotted for propagation type beacons. So that is something you want to look at. I forget exactly what the FCC rule number for that is, but I'll probably list it here. And that's something to watch out for when you're putting beacons in certain places. There are band plans that show you where those can go. One thing to also notice is that it is did take some tuning to get the Vox settings to work, for it to be keying that Vox correctly. In fact, that's why you hear a beep at the beginning of the beacon. I recorded that in there to basically kickstart that Vox circuit. But it did take a little bit of adjustment on the radio and the Pi levels to get those to cooperate. But it is the Vox setting that's built in there that's keying the rig.
Interesting project there.
Yeah, pretty cool stuff. Pretty easy to put together, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was easy. And the trick was really to get the audio level set right from when I recorded into those OGG or OGG audio files on the Pi, so that it could be decoded. I was able to work with some people within a few miles of me down here so that they could, you know, hear it, and they worked out some issues with me, like a ground loop issue I had, you know, some filters and also just to verify that we can decode the digital parts. But it's a pretty simple project and definitely cheap.
Yeah, you kept it in the required price range.
Yeah. That's right, both on the rig and the computer.
Yeah.
Kevin, was it K? Let's find it here. Kevin, K something, K4IVE, I think it was, mentioned in the chat room that that's what he does for fox hunts. So some people might get some use out of that.
Absolutely, yeah. Our club, it's been a while since they've done that, but that's a great idea to just set that recording at the lowest power setting, put it in the area somewhere, let it go. Yeah.
Cool.
The fox, right?
Yeah. Peter, you've got a Facebook post here for us,
yes,
don't you?
Oh, yes. Well, this is from Drew, and it's a picture, which, well, we'll see in a second. And if you're going to eat Vegemite, get it shoveled on, you bunch of sheilas.
Whoa. Whoa, that's pretty brave.
Couple of comments here. I'm not exactly convinced that is Vegemite. It doesn't look black enough. It looks more like treacle to me. So I've got my doubts. But the other thing is that if that is Vegemite, I recommend that you probably don't put that much on, particularly if you're not used to actually eating Vegemite. The stuff is very, very strong.
That could take paint off, couldn't it?
Yeah, that's hurting me just looking at it.
Wow. So that you don't think that's real Vegemite, Peter? You think it's what?
Something like treacle or even honey. It doesn't look like Vegemite to me. Vegemite is black.
Yeah. Yeah.
The Marmite stuff looked kind of like that, didn't it? I don't think it was quite as dark as the Vegemite.
Well, it was pretty bad.
Yeah, but remember, Marmite is fake Vegemite. So you don't even go near the stuff.
Yeah. Well, what have you got for us this month, Peter?
Oh, well, I bought a cheap laptop a little while ago. It cost me a couple of $100. Great laptop, but then it sort of fell off my desk. So here you go. Hello and welcome once again. This month, something a little bit different. My Acer Aspire E14 laptop. Now, this is just a basic laptop. It only cost me a couple of $100 a couple of years ago. It just does the basic tasks like connecting to the internet, word processing, etc. But that's all I wanted, and that's fine. It's also relatively light, which is quite good. The only problem is that it sort of fell off my desk, and now the screen is cracked, as I'll show you in a minute. Now, I could take it down to my local computer repair shop, but it might cost me a couple of $100, and that just wouldn't be worthwhile. However, I thought to myself, maybe, just maybe, I could actually repair the screen myself. So I went to YouTube and I searched around for videos about how to repair an E14 screen. Unfortunately, I couldn't find any, but I did find an E15 screen repair video. And the E15 model is very, very similar to this. So I'm hopeful that I might be able to repair this screen myself. The next thing I did was I went on to eBay and also Frugal, and I searched around for an Acer Aspire E14 screen. And lo and behold, I found one. It cost me about $40, shipped to me from China, and here it is. So let's see if we can fix this laptop. Now, here's the broken screen. The computer seems to be running okay, but as you can see, the screen is split into a number of different parts. I don't think that's caused by a loose connector or anything like that. To me, it looks like something has hit the screen and caused it to crack in various places. So the screen will have to be replaced in its entirety. All right, I've disconnected the power and also taken out the battery. So there's no power to the machine whatsoever. Now I need to pull this screen away very carefully. I should just unclip. So far, so good. Now I'm going to have a closer look at these hinges to see how I can... Oh no, here we go. Just need to flick this out here. It should come out with a little bit of a to be careful not to break it. Almost there. There we go. We've got that out. Now I've removed the bezel from around the screen, and here's my replacement screen. And as you can see, the thing that's holding the screen to the laptop are four screws. 1, 2, 3, 4. And we'll have to remove those. Now before we do that, plastic container to put our screws in as they come out. So let's get them out. That's one, and that's four. We very carefully fold that down. Be very careful about this, because there's a cable here that connects the screen to the laptop, and you don't want to damage that at all. All right, I've got a knife. Let's see if we can sort of get under this at all. And there we go. Well, probably not the best way to do that, but still, I better not pull that up too much. All right, so there's our connector. Looks like there's a bit of an adhesive tab there, and our screen is now removed. So let's now replace the screen, putting in the connector the same way, and evenly and gently pushing this into place. That looks pretty good. And then put our tape down like so to hold it in place. Next thing is to position the new screen in place and put some screws in. So I'll try not to lose the screws. There we go. Okay, now for the moment of truth. Will my screen work or not? Here goes nothing. Well, I've got some good news and some bad news. As you can see, the screen is working perfectly fine. Obviously, I can see what's being displayed on the screen. Unfortunately, what's being displayed on the screen is that there's no bootable device. But I know why that's the case. It's nothing to do with what I've been doing with the screen. It has to do with the fact that I tried to replace my hard drive with a solid state drive at one point and didn't have any success, so I put the old hard drive back in place, or at least I thought I did. I'm going to have to go back and check the connector. But as you can see, the screen is working perfectly fine. So all I need to do is to put back the bezel and clip that back into place. And I don't need to worry about this any longer. So just push that back like so. Hopefully it'll go back. Good, good, good. Gently does it. And there we go. 100% fixed screen. Perfectly fine. Now to go and work on the hard drive. Time for some hard drive debugging. Well, as you can see, I've removed the screws from the back cover and carefully folded it over like so, taking care not to damage this cable. Now, why wouldn't it boot up? Well, the reason is I didn't put the hard drive back. So now I've hunted around and I've found what I think is the old hard drive from this particular laptop. Can't be 100% certain because I've got a couple of these, but never mind. Seeing as I've got this all open, what better opportunity than to do an upgrade? Here's a Kingston 120 gigabyte solid state drive. Let's pop this in here, like so. These hard drives just slot in like so and are held in place. Nothing to screw in or anything like that. It's perfect. It'll be held by the back cover. I've now put the laptop back together again. When I did so, I had a pleasant surprise, as you'll now see. Let's boot the laptop up. And within just a second or two, I'm into a menu. I hit enter. And this won't take long. Compare this with, for example, how long Windows takes. And lo and behold, I'm into LXLE, a lightweight Linux environment. It's a version of Linux that it's got a full office suite, which is LibreOffice, and internet, which is Mozilla. Well, we've got games, accessories like your calculator, etc. So a pretty full suite of programs here in LXLE. What had happened was that, and it had slipped my mind, I actually put LXLE on that solid state drive some time ago and did actually have it running on this laptop. But I ran into a few problems. The versions of Linux, or current versions of Linux, be they Ubuntu or LXLE or whatever, and believe me, I tried a few, all couldn't run on this laptop simply because there's a Wi-Fi chipset in here which was so new that they didn't have the drivers for it. Otherwise, everything else worked perfectly fine. And this operating system will run perfectly fine as well, except that I won't be able to use the Wi-Fi. But there's a way around that. And that's simply to get a little USB Wi-Fi plug, plug that into the side of the laptop, and it will work perfectly fine. And hopefully at some stage in the future, they'll find or develop the drivers for the chipset in this particular laptop. Anyway, I've now got my operating system running on my laptop. The screen is working perfectly. I could not be happier. So, and the other thing is I've probably saved myself $160 in repair costs. So I couldn't be more pleased.
Looks like success.
Yeah. Yes, it's success, and the price is right. What do you think, Emile?
Oh, I'm loving it, Peter. I'm loving it.
Yeah, looks like a happy ending to that one.
Absolutely.
Solid-state drives are the bomb when it comes to speed, especially on boot up.
Aren't they?
Yeah, and, and the good thing is, I didn't explain this in the video, but LXLE is actually a lightweight Linux environment, so it runs really well on old hardware, and if you've got newer hardware, it runs even faster. So it's the combination of a solid-state drive with LXLE. It means that you get a really, really good result.
I have not had to do anything like that myself, replace a screen in a laptop before.
So no, I've replaced most everything in there, but I just haven't done a display.
Yeah.
But this go ahead.
Yeah. So I was just going to say, one of the purposes of making that segment was to show people that, you know, you can often find repair videos of how to fix whatever you're trying to fix on YouTube. And, go have a go. It's not as difficult as it looks.
Yeah.
But just be careful to follow the instructions.
Or you can do like us and make your repair videos.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, that's true.
I'm so cheap, Peter, that the laptop I'm on this Skype session on is a laptop with a broken display that's docked in the shack here, which just closed, and I have a television here.
Are you serious?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
I never did replace the screen, but I actually have a screen to replace it with. I just never done it.
Wow.
Yeah. Now, conversely, I do actually have plans for a future segment which does the exact opposite.
Were you going to break it?
Done. No. In fact, what I do is I have another broken laptop, right, with a really, really good screen. And it's possible to actually take the screen out and you go onto the internet. You can buy a special VGA driver, which allows you to take any source, be it HDMI, VGA, whatever, and you can build a small enclosure for your new screen, and basically you turn it into a monitor. So it's a good way of recycling old screens that are good, but where the laptop doesn't work as well. So that's something I'm hoping to do in the near future, and it's not expensive either.
I could see some use for that. I got access to a couple of broken laptops with decent screens on them.
Yeah.
You make small HDMI monitors out of them, that'd be pretty cool.
That would be. Wow. That would be nice.
Yep. And they also accept composite inputs as well. So it's really, these driver boards are really, really good.
Yeah, and we don't have composite inputs here.
No, but if it works with HDMI, I may be doing that soon myself.
We got composite.
Yeah.
But
not a lot anymore.
No, not so much. I had a nice Commodore composite monitor one time.
Composite.
Yeah.
Composite. Oh, what was that? What was that monitor? 17 something?
It could have been. It had RGB inputs on the rear.
Yeah. Yeah. And separate out the chroma and the luma, and it got real crystal clear. I remember that monitor.
Oh, yeah. I took that after I quit using the Commodores. I got a TV tuner and hooked to it. Well, actually, I think I used a cheap VCR, Emile. It was a VCR I had already. So
as a tuner?
Yep.
Yeah.
Any points for that?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yep.
And it made major cheap points.
A really nice looking television back in the analog days. Well, I think we'll take a break now. We're going to be back because we've got a lot more to go yet. I'm going to talk a little about that 433 megahertz receiver. And John Ossi is back. Remember we were talking about Jansky last show?
Uh-huh.
And he's going to wrap that up for us. And it's some really interesting stuff.
Yeah, you know, I didn't cheat and watch the second half, but I'm actually really interested in seeing the rest
There's an antenna project in here that Emil can do in his backyard that I'm really looking forward
to seeing. Pretty cheap, huh?
Well, maybe. If he can salvage it, he can come up with a cheap way to do it.
Okay.
But let's get a message now from MFJ.
RFI can wreak havoc, not only on your ham equipment, but also on other electronics in the vicinity.
MFJ comes to the rescue with the gear you need to locate the trouble and the solutions to solve it. The ultra-sensitive MFJ805 RFI detector tracks down RFI caused by radiating cables. Find exactly which cable is radiating RFI so you can eliminate it with a simple toroid or clamp-on RFI filter. Eliminate hash birdies, whistles, and transit noise from your receiver. Use it to find RFI generated by consumer devices, computers, and office equipment, too. The MFJ805 also works with mobile installations. It's easy to use. Simply clamp the current transformer over suspected cables or wires to detect RFI causing common mode currents. MFJ's 853 calibrated clamp-on RF current meter accurately measures RF current in antenna elements, ground wires, and coax shields, or slip it over a mobile whip to tune for maximum current and radiation. The MFJ915 RF isolator is a 1-to-1 HF current balun designed to be placed in line with a 50-ohm coax. 50 ferrite core beads reduces or eliminates stray RFI often found on coax. MFJ's 700 series snap-on chokes are selected for RFI suppression. Install on DC power lines to keep ignition noise from your mobile rig and amplifier. Remove RF on cables and wires in your radio station. Two-piece design snap and lock securely around your cable. Install end-to-end along rigid cable or loop multiple terms with smaller soft cable. Or choose MFJ701. Four square ferrite toroids allow you to wind all kinds of cables, computer ribbons, TV coax, power cords, telephones, and more. Learn more about MFJ's RFI solutions. Visit MFJEnterprises.com today.
MFJ's 45th anniversary, and it's the ARRL Day in the Park. Everyone's invited to come celebrate. September 29th and 30th this year in Starkville, Mississippi. They got free prizes, major prizes from MFJ, Ameritron, Cushcraft, High Gain, Mirage, and Vectronics. They're going to do the drawings on September 30th at 2 p.m. That's a Saturday. You've got to be present to win.
Yeah. And you want to be present.
Yeah.
They also got free factory tours, interesting educational tours for the whole family at MFJ, Ameritron, Cushcraft, High Gain, Mirage, Vectronics, MFJ Metal Shop. That's on Friday the 29th at 8 a.m. to 4:30 and Saturday, September 30th from 7 a.m. to noon.
And that's the big reason you want to go right there is the factory tours, man. If you go back and look through some earlier episodes of Amateur Logic, you'll see tours that we did back, how many years ago was that now?
I've been back here 9 years, and it was while I was in Missouri because I couldn't come down.
Years.
It's been about 10 years.
Yeah, 10 years ago, the last time they did this. So I'm looking forward to seeing what has changed there myself.
Well, I'm looking forward to seeing it myself. The factory tours, the videos that mm-hmm. you were able to do were really great. And actually, they were some of our most popular
yeah.
things there a long time. And but I'm looking forward to seeing it myself. I should yeah. be able to make it this time.
Yeah, it is really interesting. If you're in the South, definitely try to come to that. Emil, everything's free. So,
oh, man.
It's got yeah. the price.
Yep. And even like in free lunch.
Get out.
Yep. Mississippi Southern Fried Chicken and the Fixings in McKee Park on Saturday, September 30th from 12 to 2 p.m. You need to bring a lawn chair because it is it gets crowded there, but they have enough food to go around for sure.
Yeah, and they also have tailgating. That's free. Haggle and deal in the MFJ parking lot and also at McKee Park. That's on the 30th from 7 a.m. until 2 p.m.
And they've got free forums and demos to be announced yet. They haven't determined exactly what those will be. And they're going to give FCC license exams there.
Yeah, it looks like the Lowndes County Amateur Radio Club is going to have some VEs there. Bring your government ID and $15 cash. And that'll be on the 30th at 9 a.m.
Yep. Come on down to Starkville, Mississippi for the 45th anniversary of MFJ Enterprises and the ARRL Day in the Park, September 29th through 30th, 2017 in yeah. Starkville, Mississippi.
If you can't make it for some reason, if you're too far, they've got a special event station there, K5MFJ.
K5MFJ.
So try to get that in your logbook.
Yep. Catch them on the air.
It should be a big time. I'm really looking forward to it.
It is going to be.
You know, you were supposed to bring me back a piece of that fried chicken last time. So
yeah, but
looks I'm going to have to go get my own.
I had Wayne with me last time, and the chicken just didn't.
It never made it back down here, did it?
No.
Yeah.
I've got an email here from, not an email, an email.
Okay.
And this comes from Beat Gunnern. HB3YOL. He said, I'm a regular viewer of Amateur Logic. Your Project George experiments with the 433 megahertz transmitter and receiver modules for the Arduino was very interesting because I'm also an Arduino maker. Congratulations, Beat. Where can I find your code for the 433 megahertz transmitter and receiver modules for the Arduino? On your website, AmateurLogic.TV. I couldn't find anything. Please send me a link or your code. Thanks and kind regards. You can find that at AmateurLogic.TV/let's see. Well, I've got the link in this segment right here because, interestingly enough, that's what I'm going to be talking about tonight.
Oh, okay.
It's the 433 megahertz. We are no longer bound by 1 foot barrier.
You think we're going to make it from the end of the table, one end of the table to the other?
I believe we could.
Awesome.
Let's
that opens
see.
Up a lot more possibilities.
We can work more than the T layer.
Okay.
The T layer.
Back in January, in episode 100 of Amateur Logic, we looked at the little 433 megahertz transmitter and receiver pair that I picked up at the Huntsville Ham Fest, and we did a little experimenting with them. Unfortunately, we found that the range was only a few feet at best.
Very nice.
Yeah.
We can get about half a mile with that.
Man, I couldn't get the width of this table with this thing.
Really?
Yeah. Very discouraging. I decided to do a little experimenting and see what the problem was. The first thing that I did was go to the internet, do a little research. I was thinking I've got a quarter wave vertical here and a quarter wave ground radial on it. Well, some guy on there said that what you need is a coil loaded antenna, and he gave all the dimensions and told about how much it improved his. And so I built a couple of those and I tried them on the receiver and transmitter as well. No improvement whatsoever. And I didn't think there would be, but, made them anyway just to see.
theory would say that no, that's that's really not going to be any better than a resonant antenna. We're going to do a little experimenting here and see, well, is it the transmitter or is it the receiver? Now, the first thing I did was fire up the transmitter and look at it with a spectrum analyzer just to see what kind of signal there was there. And right there, 433 megahertz. That is a very strong signal showing up there. I'm not going to read the exact measurement there in decibels, but it's fairly high. Now, of course, the receiver and the transmitter are this close together. Well, you would think you could probably still get, some distance to that. So I'm going to take the transmitter and go as far as I can back on the other side of the room here. Now the transmitter's at least 20 feet away from my receiving antenna here. This test is far from scientific, but we can see that, there's still a fairly good signal there, way above the noise floor. So that's at minus 45, just a little better than that there on the spectrum analyzer. And this is not calibrated in any particular way. It's just for reference purposes. I'm going to add my quarter wave ground radio back. And we can see it gave just a slight improvement there to the signal. Everything's highly interactive here as I move around or move anything in the shack here. You're going to see it change, but I think my test is saying that the transmitter is okay. It's clearly above the noise level at 20 feet away, and I could probably get much further than that and still be way above the noise floor. So the next thing I did was took a UHF transmitter, which I just used MFJ266C antenna analyzer here that covers UHF. I put it on 433 megahertz, hooked my little antennas up to it, compared it with the signal that I was getting on the spectrum analyzer there, and I got just about the same, maybe slightly more out of this. However, I couldn't pick it up a bit better with the little receiver module here. Either one of those, if I got more than a foot or two away, the receiver was having problems. So at this point, I've decided it's got to be the receiver. I did some reading online and found out that, yes, these particular receiver boards right here are real poor, and people have been ordering a Super Heterodyne model to replace these with and getting much better results. So I did that. Of course, it came from China, so it took a couple of weeks to get here. This is an RXB8 module. You can find them on the internet for a few bucks. I've forgotten exactly how much I paid for that one right now. As you can see, it's got a few more parts on it than the little cheap module that we were originally using. Now, I didn't have to change my code. The same code worked with this. The pinout on it is pretty much the same, but it's labeled on the board there so you can see where you got the +5, the data, and the ground. Over here, you've got another ground where I've put my ground radio, and then also you've got a pin for the antenna there. So it's a little bit easier to hook up. Now, this one cost, several dollars more than the little one that I got with the kit, but there's no comparison between the two. I didn't really change my code much. I've made some slight changes to it just for display purposes. So here's a link where you can download a new version of it if you'd like it. I've added a 0.1 capacitor there across the power supply rails. It really didn't make any difference. But let's see how this Super Heterodyne receiver behaves. Well, it's picking up fine, 20 feet away. Do you see this other little carrier out here on the spectrum analyzer? Since this is a Super Heterodyne receiver, we're actually seeing the IF frequency there. Let's see if that's correct. Okay, we've got a marker there at 433 megahertz. And we can see that's pretty much the frequency we're operating on.
Let's put another marker on here. If you see that 2 right there, 9.333 megahertz. So it's about a 10 megahertz IF on this thing. But it's receiving very well. As a matter of fact, I took it outside and did some experimenting with it. Did I convince you to buy a spectrum analyzer, Tommy?
No. You just said. I said if I knew how to use it, I'd be tempted to buy one.
That's how you learn how to use it.
But now I'm tempted to come over here and borrow yours.
So what range were you able to get, George?
Well, and I'm glad you asked that question, Peter. I took it outside, the little transmitter, and I set it up on top of a garbage can, plastic one, just, you know, away from the building here a little bit, out and open. But so maybe it's 4 feet off the ground. And I put a 9-volt battery on it. No, actually, I think I hooked that one up to a wall wart and run an extension cord out there. So it's just sitting out in the yard. And then I took the little receiver on the breadboard and I started walking around the neighborhood. And I got about 500 feet away and it was still coming in good and strong.
Really?
Yeah.
And the other one wouldn't work from you to me.
Right. And so I decided to go on the other side of the main street over here. And now there were cars and houses and everything else blocking my signal. But I was able to walk a quarter mile away before it really got
to where it was dropping. Now, that's very useful. The other one, pretty much worthless.
No.
But that's a good, useful distance. You can do some good projects for that.
It is. Now, you know, all I was doing is using it for CW there. I was just turning the transmitter on and off. But you can actually run data into it, you know, so you could transmit text or meter readings or, you know, whatever you wanted to with it.
Yeah.
So, a very handy little thing. And you asked how much that module was. I think it was between $4 and $5 for that little receiver.
$30 to ship it from China?
No, it was pretty cheap. So, that made all the difference in the world.
Yeah.
You moved to... Go ahead, Peter.
I was going to say, it's a shame it doesn't do audio, because you could start your own little pirate radio station then.
You could do digital audio. It'd be pretty low bit rate.
You'd have to get everybody in the neighborhood to buy those little $4 modules to listen to your pirate radio station, though.
Actually, you could do AM with it if you want to get creative.
Oh, yeah?
Just turn the carrier on and, would it work? I don't know. I hadn't tried it. You might could do AM with it. Yeah.
You moved from the T layer to the G layer, from garbage can to garbage can?
Well, no, I didn't have a garbage can at the other layer, at the other end. It was the, I think it's the end layer, the neighborhood layer, maybe. I'm not sure.
Man, I got to go study again. All these propagation methods, I must have missed those.
But it was, actually, it's useful now. So,
You need to watch Ham College, Emile, so you can brush up on those.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah. An ideal use for that would actually be controlling a remote control boat of some kind.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Be perfect.
I noticed Chris, our friend KD8YVJ, you remember Chris.
Oh, yeah. I know Chris.
Cincinnati Short Rib.
Yeah.
He's playing with one right now.
Oh, yeah?
He's doing a project with it, and we'll have to see.
Yeah, I wonder what he's making
what his results are like. Yeah.
Awesome.
Okay, Emil, I think you've got some, what is it you've got to show us tonight? You kind of got off the Google Plus thing, didn't you?
Yeah, I switched back over to Facebook. In fact, there's two things. There's a post in the Facebook Amateur Logic Forum from Frank Ravenswood. What he's mentioning is the SDR sharps. You know, we've all done a segment maybe now on the dongles, right? Well, whether we use the SDR sharp program or some other SDR software, there's a piece that goes with it that will decode all, just about all of the new digital voice modes, and the public service ones as well, P25 and Clear Voice. There's all. The reason I got into it in the first place was to figure out how to decode something here that nothing I had scanner-wise or anything else could decode. So there's some neat stuff how you can pipe that audio through within the computer to a DOS-based program that decodes all of those digital voice modes, including other digital modes as well. So that was neat stuff. And I think his call was W4RAV, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, Frank's been in their Facebook group of Amateur Logic Watcher for a long time.
Yeah. Yeah. And you had another one.
I do. We took a poll of, who had Raspberry Pi. And you can see there, the 3B is the dominant one, followed by the 2B. And 0, the one you guys, I think, were asking me about, which I saw a lot of people in the chat room say they were getting. But my favorite Pi of all, of course, is the none of the above Pi. I don't have that one yet, but I hear five it might be really
it
cheap.
It looks pretty popular.
Yeah.
And then the 1A, I don't think I've ever heard of the 0 wireless one, but it was on their the website of Raspberry Pi when I saw it, so I added it on there. So.
Yeah, that's the brand new one.
So where is the regular old B, Model B, the original?
That is not even on this poll, because what I did was I went to their main website to get all of the models, I guess, that they're offering or putting there, and This is what was on that site.
Well, maybe that's the none of the above.
Yeah, because I've got two or three of them.
Uh-huh.
As I mentioned earlier, we've got a great segment here that John Ossi put together on Jansky. Before we do that, let's get a message from one of the sponsors, help pay the bills here, and we'll be right back with John's segment.
It's time to put away those winter boots and spring forward with ICOM. Base stations, mobile transceivers, handhelds, and more, ICOM has all the equipment to help make your spring full of adventure. Get out and get mobile with ICOM. Communicate with the touch of your fingertips. Perfect for small spaces, the IC7100 is the ideal D-Star option to help communicate anywhere. Angled control head and touchscreen for quick intuitive operation, large internal speaker for clear digital audio, and it's perfect for multi-band and all-mode communications. Do you have spring travel plans this year? Back for a limited time, the IC7200 is a great option for hams wanting a device to carry out into the field. Simple and tough with IFDSP, digital noise reduction, and USB port for PC control. Ideal for the ham on the go, try the IC7300. It's a high-performance, innovative HF transceiver with a compact design. RF direct sampling, 15 discrete bandpass filters, large 4.3-inch color touchscreen, real-time spectrum scope, SD memory card slot, and more. Visit icomamerica.com/amateur for more information on all ICOM radios.
As I mentioned, John Ossi, N3DRH, does a presentation on Karl Jansky, the father of radio astronomy, or so he's credited with being. This is really good. Emile, get your notepad out so you can take notes on this antenna system here.
Hey, this is John, N3DRH, and we want to finish up part two of Jansky and how he discovered, or how he invented, inadvertently, radio astronomy. All right? So here's a picture of Carl at his chart recorder, which is the predominant way they recorded the noise level. And if you notice up at the top, he is actually plotting the intensity of radio signals in different portions of the sky. And what's curious about that is that the antenna that he made was fully rotatable in azimuth, but had no elevation capability whatsoever. So how do you think he was able to get to other portions of the sky? You'll have to just follow along. The antenna that he used was a Bruce antenna array, named after Dr. Array. No, it was Edmund Bruce. And there is an example from the ARRL 19th edition of the antenna book. And it is a, what is it? It's a broadside or curtain array. And each segment of the box, of the boxes are a quarter wavelength. You can have as many boxes, I guess, as you want. But the boxes hang vertically, hence the name curtain. It runs about 250 to 300 ohm impedance. It was patented in 1927 by Edmund Bruce, also of Bell Labs, probably in the same radio group as Jansky. And Bruce later on went on to invent and patent the rhombic antenna. So you saw this. This is what it looks like. But how do you feed one of these guys? And interestingly, every reference that I found basically feeds it in one of the vertical elements. Before I do that, the tails at the end of boxes can either go in or out, apparently. But all the feed points in all the references, including the ARRL references, show it as you break one of the center segments, and then that's how you feed it. And it doesn't matter how many portions, I don't want to call them elements, because this is really a single element as I'm depicting it here, single element with a single driven element. But the portions of the boxes are always fed from the vertical side, unless, of course, you're Karl Jansky. Okay, so again, the red showing up where they show the feed line being attached. All right. So this is the representation of the driven element that Jansky used. And, of course, I already told you that each segment is a quarter wavelength. And he made this thing on a gigantic frame that would enable 360-degree rotation. Not just rotation, but continuously rotating unaided with a motor. The other unique thing that no one seems to have else has done is he added a reflecting element in the back, a passive reflector, that was 15%, I should say, not larger, but taller than the driven element. In the horizontal, the reflector was exactly the same dimensions, but it was extended 15% taller in the vertical dimension. And because it was a two-element antenna, John Krause called it a Bruce beam in one of his references. And here's the other strange thing that no one else seems to have done, and there are no references to this other than to Jansky, is that he fed it with a T-match on the center of the horizontal segment. So doesn't that make it a horizontally polarized antenna? I think so. Some of you antenna experts correct me if I'm wrong. In an IEEE publication and other publications, any publication on Bruce arrays, whether they're referring to Jansky's or anyone else's, they always say that they're vertical antennas by their nature. I don't think so, though, but I might need correcting on that. Here is what appears to be a diagram from his notebook. Notice the two elements up at the top. Obviously, the driven element is the one attached to, the termination circuit. And there is the T-match right here. And that's connected to one side. And, of course, the other side connected to the antenna itself. So you don't break the antenna at all, as in a vertical. You just connect it to the center. And it comes down here to a tuned circuit, inductively coupled to a tuned circuit. And then it goes into this thing. Which apparently they call a pipe transmission line. I'm guessing because coax didn't exist back then, at least in the sense that we have it today, is that you had to make coax out of pipe. So again, if you have any historians there who can correct me on that, I'd sure like to know. Here's the actual antenna with Jansky in front of it. This is one of the best pictures. Take a good look. You can see the elements closer to Jansky are obviously the reflectors, because they're taller, and the ones out front behind him in the back are the driven element. You can't really see the T-match at all. It's hidden amongst all the 2x4s, but it's there. And then you can see right away how he did the 360-degree rotation was on this track and with these Model T wheels. Notice he used 7/8 inch brass tubing, 411 feet of it. So this, just the metal part of this antenna might have weighed 450 pounds. I mean, it could have been as light as 250, but it could have gone all the way up to 450 pounds. And the wavelength he operated on was about 14.6 meters. Right. Curiously, if you take a quarter of a wavelength of 14.6 meters, you get mighty, mighty close, within a few percent of 12 feet. Guess how long brass tubing comes in, the lengths that it's available in. You're right, 12 feet. So here's the active element. Like I told you, it's out front. I've highlighted in yellow, just in case you can follow it through all the lines. That's the passive reflector. That, so there's this curious thing. As you'd expect it to be larger, you wouldn't necessarily expect it to be larger in the horizontal, but certainly larger in the vertical. But here's the strange thing about it being larger in the vertical, is it's not center to center with the driven element. The bottom of the passive reflector is exactly coincident with the bottom of the driven element. So the reflector sits up above a bit, which might have lowered the vertical beam path a bit. Of course, there's the wheel track, which you can see is a bunch of bricks. And then he used Model T wheels, which were readily available in the 30s. When they tried to make the reproduction in the 60s, they had sort of a tough time finding Model T wheels that were in good condition. They really made the reproduction of this, which still exists at Green Bank, exactly as Jansky made it. You can go see it if you want to. Then you can't see this, but he did a 1/4 horsepower motor with a reduction gear so that this thing on its own would rotate every 20 minutes. All right. I think that means that about each degree is about 3 seconds. So this thing is very slowly rotating. Here's the working replica at Green Bank. I talked to Bill Brundage, K8HUH, who's now NM5WB, who fired this thing up with some other hams on at the Green Bank, and they made some contacts on 15 meters back in 82. Here's the top view. The driven element, of course, is in the front, the passive radiators in the back. And what I want you to see from this picture is here is the motor box. Here's where the quarter horsepower motor is. This is a motorcycle chain that is pulling this guy around at a really slow rate. Gets really geared down, so as to move rather slowly. And there are the Model T wheels. And you might be, if you're thinking ahead, you win the prize of how do you connect a cable to this when it is continuously rotating. Well, this is the way Jansky did it, and this is how they did it on the reproduction, is they made a sleeve bearing. So this thing is sliding, essentially continuously rotating conductors against each other. It's amazing that didn't cause noise sufficient to block what he was trying to accomplish. Here's the actual beam width, the horizontal beam width of the replica. The guys, the hams who ran this, said they noticed it had an incredible null in the back, and sure enough, it does. Here's the vertical beam pattern. The black is what is calculated, and then the red they actually measured by sending a little miniature 15-meter transmitter aloft with balloons at different heights to get an idea of the single string. One of the reasons he was successful, we love sunspots, some of us, so that we can bounce our signals off the ionosphere and keep them close to home. But although he was not, his desire was not to try and get radio signals from outside the solar system, had he been operating almost any place else other than 1930 to 32 or maybe 33, the ionosphere would have cut him off. It would have reflected back the wavelengths that he was working at, and he never would have seen or heard, I should say, those signals from the center of the galaxy. Here's one of the recordings. Notice, if you look carefully, There is a peak every 20 minutes. Well, obviously, he has the source of this radio signal in its sights, and every 20 minutes, as the antenna swings around, you get the peak. So when how is he filling the rest of the sky, though? Because this antenna can only move in azimuth, not in elevation. And, well, the Earth is used as to try and get to the aspect of elevation to some degree. So you can cover quite a bit of the sky if you keep recording over long enough periods of time. And what he found was that if you let this go for a while, then the peak would disappear. In other words, the stars would move, essentially, and even though you were pointed in the right direction in azimuth, you couldn't be pointing in the right direction anymore in elevation. The stars had, you know, for lack of a better term, had rotated themselves because of the Earth's rotation around the outside of the beam path of the antenna. And what he noticed was that when he first began to quantify this was that it looked like it was on a 24-hour period, and it looked like it was lined up with the sun. And the sun, you know, radio astronomy, you can do day or night. You don't have to do it at night. But the sun was expected, although it wasn't until World War II that the sun was confirmed to be a source of radio waves, mostly at way high frequencies. It wouldn't have been a surprise back then to find the sun as a radio source, even though it wasn't confirmed. But he found that over time, the sun slowly began to move away from the source, but the source continued to point towards Sagittarius, which is essentially the center of the Milky Way. Bell Labs jumps on this right away. They do two things. They line them up to give a talk in Washington, D.C. at a scientific symposium. And they send a press release to New York Times. They put it on the front page in May of 33. And notice right here it says, "Don't worry, there's no evidence of interstellar signaling." In other words, these aren't beings out there sending us a signal, trying to prevent mass havoc. There's the actual picture of the one he built in Green Bank. They must have hired a plane to do that, I'm guessing. And now you know how he can really plot radio intensities over the vast majority of the constellation dome. If you do it long enough over a period of a year or more, you can get an idea of where the signals are the strongest. Here is a memorial that was put in, I think, in the late 90s. At the location of Bell Labs in Holmdel, New Jersey. There's the location in case you want to visit sometime. And there, this artist's rendition does justice to what he performed. Why was he successful? Well, Joe Taylor said that he was a very capable scientist, and he had a mind that expected nature to reveal itself. There's also some other reasons the sunspot was important as well. So I hope you've enjoyed this. If you have any other questions or comments, or if you have answers to some of my questions, please shoot them on. Thanks a lot. This is N3DRH out.
What do you think, Tom?
That was a fantastic presentation, man. It's really amazing.
Yeah. Thanks to our friend John Ossi, N3DRH, who happens to be in the chat room
right
now.
Yeah, I think I saw him in there.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was great. Really appreciate you sharing that with us. So, Emile? You got that antenna started?
No. That's not going to my backyard anytime soon.
What about you, Peter? You got plenty of room down there in the outback.
Yeah, in the outback we would, but it's a long way away from where I live. So, But I was fascinated by the antenna and how it's constructed. I've never seen anything quite like that. It's quite unusual.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing stuff.
Yeah, it really was, and both the segments together were very good. Great work. I didn't know really about Jansky.
I didn't either, but I'm going to go look that up and see about watching if there's some other stuff out there, checking it out.
Yeah, that had to, at the time, been just cutting-edge stuff, man.
Oh, yeah.
Just like...
Isn't it a measurement? metric as well. I've heard of Jansky's before.
You have?
I have. Yeah, it's like a measurement of signal, maybe, or, you know, so many Jansky's. I've heard of that before. I just don't remember what the metric is.
I have not, so I don't know.
I don't know. Sometimes things cost me a 5-ski or a 20-ski.
They cost Emile a 1-ski.
A 1-ski.
Oh, wait, I found it here. I Googled it. The Jansky, symbol is JY, is a non-SI unit of spectral flux density or spectral irradiance, used especially in radio astronomy. It's equivalent to 10 to the minus 26 watts per square meter per hertz.
Well, there you go. I guess you know who that was coined after.
Yep. No doubt.
Yeah. No doubt. Put that to rest for sure.
I think we've about come to the end of another exciting episode here. Seems everyone made it all the way through.
Made it through it okay. Everybody is still in one piece?
Yep.
Yes. Yeah, so that's good.
Yep.
Well, before we go, a couple
that's
of things.
Better than last month turned out.
I'm surprised everybody showed back up after that.
Yeah, no kidding.
Well, before we go, a couple of things we want to mention. One is we were talking about that Amateur Logic swag earlier. Where can you get that, Tommy?
She saw me at AmateurLogic.Spreadshirt.com. And wear it and represent proud and take some selfies of yourself and you may end up on Amateur Logic.
Yep. When you want to find the show notes on Amateur Logic, I believe, if I'm correct, in the chat room here.
Yeah, he was in there a little while ago.
Yeah, he's still in there. Yeah. Dan.
So he must be still being one piece, too. After. Yep.
N9LVS, our wiki master.
Yep.
Does the wiki for Amateur Logic with the show notes. AmateurLogic.TV/wiki. You can find those there.
Yeah, thanks so much for doing that, Dan. Yeah. Really appreciate it.
Big help.
We need to get him an Amateur Logic shirt that says Wiki Meister on it.
We do.
Did you say Wiki Meister or Wiki Monster?
Meister.
Meister.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Meister. Okay.
Yeah. All right. Any final parting thoughts before we go, Tommy?
No. I think it was a pretty good show.
I think it was, too.
I know I had fun, so
I had fun.
That's any measure of how it turned out. But I guess we'll see you guys next month.
Yeah. I had fun, too. You know, it's always exciting when you can increase the range of your ham station from 1 foot to a quarter mile. You know.
Yeah, that's quite an increase.
It is. Just think about the gain involved. Well, really, there was no gain involved. Transmitter was working fine all along. It was a receiver. So it was interesting to find that out. And I'm fortunate to have a spectrum analyzer so I could actually quantify that the transmitter was, was in fine condition there. Peter,
what is that measurement? Synad, right? The receiver's performance?
I didn't actually go down and I could have determined that, but I didn't look that far.
I'd like to learn how to do that one day. I've seen a whole bunch of repair type forums on YouTube, and they have some pretty highfalutin equipment from what I can see doing that.
Yeah. Any final words from down south there, Emil?
No, other than I'll just keep taking bites out of pie and being cheap as possible. I'm hooked. Thanks a lot, guys.
Oh, you're welcome, and you've been, shall I say, very successful at it so far.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Seems like you're right on track.
Having fun.
Peter, anything from really far south?
Yeah, the only thing I would say is about when it comes to ballooning, don't overfill your balloon. to be exact, because it is critical.
You think there's any...
Find out about that next month.
Well, we'll look forward to learning more about that from you next month. Me, I don't know what I'm going to do next month. We'll just have to wait and see.
Yeah, I've got two things I'm working on. So depends on which one has the most success as to which one's going to make it.
There you go. We may never hear about the other one.
You may never hear about the other one.
Okay.
It wouldn't be the first time that's ever happened.
No, probably wouldn't be.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks for being here, everyone. We had a great time, and I'm glad you could be with us.
Yep, 73.
73.
73.
And then a left-handed, I can't hardly say it. Talking about that Amateur Logic swag earlier, where can you get that, Tommy?
Yeah, get you some at AmateurLogic.sweatshirt.